Hello everyone on the internet, welcome to another episode of the Fueled by Coffee podcast. My name is Matt, I'm your host. Thank you for stopping by, hope you enjoyed your stay. Just like to give a big thank you to the three people that listened to the last episode. Got lots of fun ones lined up. We've had a couple really good ones, music related ones, to start off the season. And today we got a little bit more of a football themed episode, but it's not like sports ball football. I know there are people that listen to the pod who aren't like football people and they don't really like the football episodes, but this is different. This is fantasy football, completely different world. We're going to jump into all the craziness of that. Today I am here with my cousin Anthony. We planned on doing this episode like a little over a year ago. It was kind of wild. You guys were up visiting from Alabama, Roll Tide. And
Roll Tide.
Y'all were up visiting, and I was finishing up the last episode of season one, and I don't know, we were just kind of talking about like, yeah, we should do one, and now we're finally doing it. So super happy to have you on, man.
Glad to be here. I've been looking forward to this.
Yeah, man, I've been excited, as we do with every episode, drinking coffee. And I'm excited. So we're doing this over Zoom because obviously we're like hundreds of miles away. And I was excited to find out that you were drinking coffee as well. Today I am currently drinking Bones Coffee Company. It's like Dusk Donuts at Dusk or something like that. It's a jelly donut flavored coffee. People, you know, it sounds weird, but like,
no, it sounds I'm a coffee enthusiast. It, you know, keeps me from wanting to kill myself every day. So jelly donut themed coffee does sound pretty good.
I don't know, I've been wanting it for months, and then my girlfriend got it for me for Christmas, and like I tried it black and it just tasted like black coffee, and then I tried it with oat milk and that just tasted like black coffee with oat milk. But the secret is using vanilla creamer that like brings out the jelly donut flavor. So really,
I get a lot of shit from mainly my girlfriend, and you know, Beth, my dad's soon to be wife. He actually, it's his fiance. She just proposed, but I get a lot of shit because I do over, like, if I just, I'm not a huge fan of like the black coffee.
Yeah,
I'm not a huge fan of just the taste. Like my roommate can just straight up sit there and drink black coffee. And he's like, oh yeah, my dick's hard, black coffee. And then me, on the other hand, I'm like, dude, it needs some fucking flavor.
Yeah.
But that's why I liked, like right before you know, started recording, I mentioned like having the coffee that I'm drinking because I brewed my own cup for this special occasion. And I do, that's what I enjoy about like the Jack Daniels, it's whiskey flavored coffee, and it tastes like fucking whiskey.
That's crazy.
And yeah, it's pretty good. Pretty good little coffee. But yeah. Sweet. I know that the people aren't going to be like watching the video, but I am drinking out of my Black Rifle Coffee Company mug.
Hey man, you got to give him the shout outs. I'm hoping to get some sort of coffee endorsement this year. That'd be really cool.
That'd be nice.
Yeah, Wawa, please sponsor me. I'm going to say that every episode. Did I take you to Wawa when you guys were up visiting?
Oh yeah, yeah. I heard about Wawa. From what I gathered, it's the little high school hangout spot, kind of like the Sonic in the South. You know?
Yeah, man. Lots of cool stuff to talk about. Just a little recap, the last couple episodes were music related. For those who haven't heard them, I recommend that you check them out. I did one with my friend Aaron. We talked about my music projects I've done. And then the one after that was Aaron's brother Pete. We talked about his new band. We jammed one of their new songs and talked the Birds a little bit, the disappointing 2020 Eagles season. So lots of fun stuff, something for everyone. But we're just going to jump right in. So Anthony and I, we're only a couple years apart. I just turned 23. You're what, like?
I'm 18. I turned 19 in July. So yeah, about five-ish years.
Yeah.
Around that ballpark.
And like we grew up kind of around each other. Like our families would visit each other, but there was always like that disconnect of like me being a little bit older and you being a little kid and me just like being a moody teenager and not wanting to be bothered, you know? So like, but it was really cool. Like you guys came to visit for the first time in like 10 years or something like that. And us being adults now, it was really cool to just be able to like sit back and just like actually hang out and be like, yo, like we actually connect now. Like that's really cool. You know, we went on a couple wild little adventures we're going to get into then. But yeah, super cool. And then through that trip, you guys actually, you and your dad and Bethany, your dad's fiance, you guys, I guess, baited me into joining your fantasy football league, the Gerba yes. League. Do you want to give a rundown for those who don't know? Like, fantasy football, it's something that people take very seriously. It's not sports ball football. It's its own monster. Like,
and it's so crazy because like it really isn't. And even like Beth, my dad's fiance, she isn't even into football. Like, she's not a big fan of watching it, but Dave like had her join and she like started listening to these fantasy football podcasts and like mm-hmm. she's getting into it. It really is its own like little fucking cult.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, so yeah, we got the basis of the league. For those that don't know, fantasy football is pretty much you draft your own fantasy team that consists of multiple players, and you get points for each player every Sunday that they play, or Monday or Thursday, whichever games they play. And they get points based off how well they do. And there's a lot of, you know, plotting and shit to go into this. The basis on how the league started was because Joe, which is my uncle, it's technically your first cousin, but he reached out and he was like, hey, we should start a, you know, old Joe, he's real uppity, love him to death. He's like, hey, we should start this fantasy football league. And just like, all right, cool. And I had only played like one time, and my dad's fucking into it,
By the way, before you continue, was he really upset that I completely swept him this season, all three times I played him?
Mad as fuck.
Yes, that's amazing. Sorry, Dave, love you.
It was so funny, man. But yeah, he was pretty pissed off about that. But yeah, we started this league. We played the first season, which was the previous season before this one.
Yeah.
It's not a very old league. Played the first season, and it was, you know, quite a few people. It was me, my dad, Walt Willie, which is my grandfather. Then there's Joe, James. Then we had Joe's wife and James's wife. And then after that, some things happened. And then we added you. But there's a whole lot to unpack with the fantasy football league. Just drama.
Like, yeah. Like, so like layman's terms for like how a game is structured. I've tried to like explain this to people before. It's like you get points for what each player does. So like you have, it's mainly just like offensive positions, and then like you draft like a whole defense. And then like you get points for like every time someone catches the ball, every touchdown, every, you know, yards gained, like you get points for that. And like it's hard to explain to people. It's not like, oh, they score a touchdown, so you get 7 points like in real life. It's like each league sets up their own point systems. So yeah, it's just kind of like a league to league thing, I guess. I don't know. Like, how would you like explain that for people who don't know?
Yeah, it's a hard, like, tricky thing to understand unless like you actually do fantasy football.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel like you explained it pretty well. Pretty much, you know, there's the NFL, all these teams and all these players, and certain players are better than other ones. So you're gonna want to like draft these better players because they're gonna score more points based off of what your scoring system is. But yeah, you pretty much just draft your own team and then you face off against each other and whatever.
Yeah. And, you know, this year was my first year ever doing fantasy football. For those who have listened to, like, the whole Fueled by Coffee podcast in its entirety, you would have heard that, like, I think it was episode 2, the very first season. I, like, was into football as a little kid. Then I got out of sports. I hated sports for, like, the longest time. I was just an edgy teenager. And then, like, I was an Eagles fan growing up, like, hands down, like, loved the Eagles, had a Brian Dawkins jersey, saw them at training camp in Bethlehem, you know, had the Madden with Donovan McNabb on the cover, you know, just like, I was, you know, I was like an Eagles fan, football fan, little kid, you know. And then I got into other stuff and I was like, oh, sports are dumb, like, I'm not watching football anymore, it's boring, you know. Like, I had these associations with it. Like, we'd go over to my grandparents on my dad's side, and they pretty much every Sunday, like, they had football on. They were Eagles fans until the Eagles signed Michael Vick. And then my dad's mom was like, she was like a huge like SPCA donor. She was like, I'm not an Eagles fan anymore because Michael Vick hurt dogs. So then she was a Giants fan. So just like, yeah.
Which isn't, you know, I mean, it's not really, I feel like that's a step to the side, you know, if you're going to ditch your team. I feel like if I were just to ditch the Pittsburgh Steelers, I'd be like, fuck it, I'm a Chiefs fan now.
Yeah.
Which for those of you who don't know, it's kind of like upgrading from like, oh, you don't want the Volkswagen? Go, let's try the BMW.
Yeah, and, yeah. You know. Yeah, so like, and I just remember having these like reservations about football that like, because we'd go over there and I felt like it was like they would do a play and then go to commercial, and then there'd be like two plays and then they'd go to commercial, and then there'd be a field goal and then go to commercial, and like I guess I just wasn't paying close enough attention to realize like, you know, there was so much more to the game than that. But yeah, for years like I just wasn't into football, and then, you know, a few years ago, I remember my mom being like, oh, the Eagles are in the Super Bowl against the Patriots. And then, like, I'm, you know, there's me having, like, a Vietnam flashback to my childhood when the Eagles lost to the Patriots the first time. So I was like, dude, like, my life just came, my childhood just came full circle. So, like, you know, of course I watched the game. And, like, it was a really good game. Like, it totally shattered any thoughts I had about football prior to that. Like, it was just, it was fun, it was exciting, there's lots of scoring, and I was like, wow, like I could see myself watching this every week. And that got me back into it, you know, that got me back into the Eagles and all that stuff. And like you said, you know, like, you don't just ditch a football team. Like, the Eagles just had one of the worst seasons I think they could have ever had. And I'm still an Eagles fan. Like, I'm not going to be like, oh, like, screw the Eagles now, you know? Like, that's, you know, every team is allowed to have a bad year. So, but yeah, you guys, so basically you guys got me into the fantasy football thing. And yeah, I was so unsure of it. Like, I remember texting you like before the draft day. And I was like, dude, like, I don't know. I don't want to pick someone that makes me look stupid. Yeah. Or like, you know, like, oh, I don't want to look dumb. Like, I just didn't want to look dumb. Like, I know football and like I know who's good and who's not good, but like,
that's the thing about fantasy football, is that it's not like, it doesn't, it's, there's so much more than like whether players are good or not. Mm-hmm. It's looking at like the guys that they have around them. Yeah. For running backs, if you look at their offensive line, you know, that has a lot to do with it. Mm-hmm. For example, like, for those that don't know, Ezekiel Elliott, he is a running back for the Dallas Cowboys. Really good player, but his quarterback, you know, that little duo right there, that they go one in hand. Dak Prescott got hurt, and he was shit the entire year just because he couldn't, like, he didn't have that guy around him. So that's, if I were to explain it like that, then yeah, you know, it's just a lot of things go into it. But yeah, we got Matt into the Fantasy Football League. And then the drama begins.
Oh, yeah.
I was waiting for it.
Yeah, so let's start from the top. Let's start draft day. I was nervous. I remember I worked. It was a Saturday. And I was like, I got to go home. I got to go to sleep. I got to do my laundry. I got to be on the draft by 4 p.m. Like, I was really nervous. Like, I literally had the runs because of, like, how nervous I was making myself. And it's, like, over a stupid game, you know? I was just like... And then once I got into it and I was like... You know, I think I did a good job drafting my team. And I got this email from NFL Fantasy that's like, your team is projected to win 3 games this year. And I was like, all right. And I ended up finishing 3rd place. But yeah, so let's go to draft day. There was some drama on draft day, if you want to dive into that.
So yeah, the drama pretty much consists with, obviously, you know, I don't know how many people watch sports listening to the podcast and, you know, all that, but you draft these players, and pretty much how we were setting it up, since there was 2 new teams this year, is that it was going to be in a random draft order, right? And but we were going to make sure that my dad, Dave, who was the winner of the league last year, was going to have the last pick. For some reason, I don't remember exactly how it went down, but that's pretty much what it was.
Well, wasn't it to make sure that Walt Willie got the first pick?
Yeah.
Because he,
which. So it was to make sure that Walt Willie got the first pick because his team, you know, it's always rough. But so pretty much the day that the draft comes around, and I remember this happening. I remember the draft was starting. It was like, your team is now on the clock. And like, the way that my dad explained it, because we weren't together at the time, he was like, well, I didn't realize it, but the Commissioner Joe pretty much like kind of somewhat messed up the order. Yeah. I don't know exactly how it happened, but it pretty much flipped them. So the person who was supposed to get the first pick got the last pick, and the person who's supposed to get the last pick got the first pick.
Yeah.
And everyone was like, what the fuck? This is retarded. And just pretty much pissed off about it. And yeah, but that's pretty much the gist of it. It sounds really dumb, but yeah, people were mad about that. It wasn't the biggest deal ever. It wasn't obviously the biggest ordeal out of the whole season, but it was just starting off on the wrong foot.
Yeah, I remember the group chat was blowing up, and like Dave was like, stop this shit now, postpone this shit now. Like, he's like freaking out about it. And, you know, because my cousin Dave, Anthony's dad, is a very intense guy. And like, when he's passionate about something, like, he is very passionate about it. Is that fair to say, you think?
That's a very Drew Sargent-esque personality. He's chilled out a lot, but yeah, he stresses over that shit a lot. And whenever he does something, he wants to make sure that's all perfect.
Yeah.
And another thing that kind of leads into this is that. So he'd been doing fantasy football for a while with a group of his friends and buddies. He'd done it for like 4 or 5 years before this draft.
Mm.
And he knew everything. And he was like talking to Joe, and he was like, make me the fucking commissioner next year. Everything will go fucking smoothly. Just fucking make me the commissioner. And Joe was like, nah, I got it. I remember Joe at one point actually texting in the group chat, like with just me, my dad, Uncle James, Uncle Joe, and Walt Willie. And I remember Joe just texting back, like, bro, chill out. You need to smoke some trees. And I remember my dad getting super pissed off and being like, what the fuck are you talking about smoking trees, man?
That's amazing. Oh, my God. Yeah, dude. Oh, so much fun. Like, the whole draft thing, like, didn't really affect me because I was, like, middle of the pack. Like, so I took over someone else's team, and basically, like, my team, I guess, had finished, like, fourth or fifth. So, like, every time the draft order would reverse, we only had 8 teams in the league. It really didn't affect me because I was like right in the middle. So I was like, oh, whatever, like, you know. And but yeah, like for that little, like, so basically the other thing that the league did last year that we're not doing this year, just to get like a fresh start, we had like keeper players. And so like a keeper is basically what it sounds like. You can pick one player from your previous team to roll over onto your next team. And so Dave had this running back, Christian McCaffrey, who's like one of like the, I guess, superstar running backs. I mean, he was hurt a lot of this season, but he's like, he can catch the ball, he can run the ball, like he's super agile, like he's a really good, really good running back for those who don't know. And so Dave had him, and so then when Dave got the first pick, he took another running back who was super good, Saquon Barkley, who was like, you know, at the time he got hurt early in the season, but he was like a top 3 or top 5 running back coming into the season. So like that basically enabled Dave, who was the previous champion, to load up on 2 really good players like right from the start.
And what's so funny is that it just kind of, to the gist of it is, yeah, like it just loaded up the previous champion. Now he has 2, probably the number 1 and the number 2 coming into the season. Number 1 and number 2 running backs on his team.
Yeah,
like that's a consistent win every mm-hmm. week. The ironic thing is that
karma,
both of those guys got fucking hurt. Like all of his guys got hurt, and I remember the entire year, every time that he got beat, he would be like, well, it's because my whole fucking team got hurt, and my this and that. And he was like talking about it, and like, yeah, it sucks. Like, yeah, your whole team got hurt. He was like, I guarantee you, if anybody else had the same exact scenario happen with them, they wouldn't be in the fucking playoffs. They wouldn't be where I was this year.
Well, and okay. So I'm gonna just throw it out there. I'm sending this to the group chat when it comes out. But like, Dave, I had like half of my team out with COVID at one point. And I had to piecemeal together a team, and I still finished 8-6 in third place. I still swept you, brother. So, I mean, yeah, it sucks. I was like, oh, dude, that sucks. But then, like, so that whole thing, so it was like week 2 or week 3, his top 2 running backs were hurt. And I remember that was like a whole nother piece of drama that was like, he almost quit the league. Like 3 weeks into a 15-week season, he was like ready to just split.
That's a whole different thing. I think that was a lot of tension buildup just boiling over, and then finally he just exploded too. But it was also because I had drafted this guy, Leonard Fournette, who was also a running back, and he was kind of uncertain. Coming into the season.
About this.
And so pretty much week two or week three, week four maybe, Leonard Fournette puts up 27 points, which is a lot for a running back. It's a good amount for any, you know, player that you draft. So it's looking, you know, like he has some upside, like, oh, this, he can put up 20 points every week. He's going to be a good running back. And so he reached out to me and he was like, hey, do you want to make this trade? And it was for like this wide receiver. And then, and I was going to give him this running back. And I decided after doing it that I was like, man, after I accepted it, because I accepted it really quick, I was like, man, I don't want to do this trade. So I went back and I actually looked at the thing, and I was like, what the fuck? I can't like decline it after I've accepted it. I thought I could. And so after that, I was like, it was a shitbag move. I texted everyone except for Dave, and I was like, yo, veto this trade. And for those of you that don't know, vetoes are only supposed to be used if there's any type of collusion inside of it. And it's pretty much if you get enough votes to stop this trade from happening, then it'll be stopped. And but you're not supposed to use it in this certain scenario, because I was just dumb and already accepted the trade.
Yeah.
And
well, not to cut you off, but like that's like me trading you Stephon Diggs for Todd Gurley that I don't even think I put in my lineup. That was like I made some really stupid trades, and we'll get into that then, because I'm just too nice. But anyways, continue. There was, you know, you texted all of us.
Yeah. But I pretty much texted everybody. I remember texting Matt. I texted Joe, who's the commissioner. I texted everybody, and he actually figured out, because I texted Beth, his fiance, and it was a dumb idea. I shouldn't have. and I was like, hey, just don't tell him, but just veto this trade, okay? And then it kind of just boiled over. I don't remember exactly how it happened, but I remember the group chat kind of blowing up. Dave was like, this is fucking bullshit. I'm getting fucked out of this fucking season. And I was like, nah, man, like, it's chill.
Yeah. And like, James is always trying to be the peacekeeper. So James was like, dude, like, it's cool. Like, you know, like whatever. And it's funny. I think it was like a Monday night. I'm sitting there at home and like, we're watching Monday Night Football, and I'm sitting there with my parents, and I'm like, Mom, like, Dave is literally, like, blowing a head gasket right now over this whole thing. Dave was like, I'm going to quit. I'm done. Good luck, Beth. I'm giving it up to you to win the season. Like, he was so pissed. did you see him in person? Like, when that was going on, did you see him in person at all?
I didn't. So I live like an hour and a half away from him, and I visit him like every other weekend, maybe once a month sometimes. But whenever I saw him the next time, we didn't really talk about it much.
Yeah.
Cause I mean, he kind of called me back and forth, and I told him it, and he was like, after that day, he just kind of, you know, was chilled out about it, and was like, just accepted it for what it was. It was just like, yeah, that's fine. I'm still going to beat everyone's asses. I'm still going to fucking win the league. And I was like, all right.
Yeah, I remember it was like this whole big thing. Like Anthony said, it was like a huge buildup, and he just like blew up, and like the group chat was blowing up, and it was like 20 text messages every 30 seconds. And then I remember like the next day or 2 days later, Dave sends this like long, super long like apology to the group chat, and I remember being like, I didn't even finish it, because I was like, dude, like, you're good, like, I don't really care, man, like, it you know, I thought it was funny. I was having a laugh the whole time.
I don't know if you knew this. I don't think he really told anybody. He broke his phone over that. Did you know that?
So is that why? Because I remember Beth texted and she's like, David doesn't have his phone right now.
God. He broke his phone. And I remember at first, whenever I asked him, I was like, he was like, I don't have my phone. It's getting fixed, or I'm getting a new one or something. I was like, how did you do that? And he was like, oh, I dropped it or something. He said something like that. Good and Lord. I was like, yeah, okay. Yeah, sure.
That's amazing.
And then he ended up messing up. And he was like, yeah, I fucking broke it. Like, slammed my phone on the table or ground or something. And I was like, It's like, man.
That's awesome. I mean, we've all been there, I think. Like, we've all had those things where it's just, like, stupid angry over something. Like, happens to me more often than
it
should.
Yeah.
Oh, like, my God. But, yeah, like, you know, he sends this whole long apology, and I was just like, dude, like, I thought it was funny, so, like, you're good. Like, I didn't think anything of it. But, yeah, so, like, after that, I feel like the season went pretty smoothly. Like, things kind of just...
I don't know if smoothly was the way that I'd describe it, Matt, but you know.
Wait, are you talking about some of the trades that were made? Is that
okay? So first of all, I want to address since we're on the topic of like vetoes and stuff. So do you remember the trade with you and James that I don't know if it well, actually I do know what happened, but so pretty much
did y'all veto it?
No. Oh. I thought I explained this to you. So I thought I did. No.
So just to give context, I was really short on running backs. I had one who had COVID for like 3 weeks. I had another one that Dave traded me who was really good, but he kept getting hurt. He's a piece of glass. And then I was – and like the thing is like the way our league functioned was like running backs were like the key because like they got points for catching passes, for running, for like they were like way too overpowered. And so like I was like, hey James, like, because I tried picking up, so there's this rookie running back for the Colts, his name's Jonathan Taylor, for those who don't know, he was like starting to blow up last season, and I tried picking him up off of waivers, which, just to explain real quick, waivers are like players that aren't on any teams currently, and it's like when the week ends on a Monday till Wednesday, you can like put players on your waiver list, and then on Wednesday the waiver's clear, and then like if you claim them higher than someone else, you'll get the player on your team. But it goes through similar to like the draft, I think. Does it go through like each team? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Everybody has certain waiver priorities. So like if I lose this week and you win this week, mm-hmm. and we both try to set waivers for the same player, mm-hmm. since I lost, I'd have a higher waiver priority and I'd get the better bid.
Yeah. So I tried picking up this running back and someone else got him. And so like a couple weeks down the road, I hit up my cousin James because he had him. And I was like, hey man, like, is there anyone you'd be willing to trade for Jonathan Taylor? Like, I really need a running back, and I, you know, I'd be willing to get and he give up, you know, whoever. And he was just, I was like, just let me know like who you want. And he was like, oh man, well, like, I'll take Henry Ruggs because he's a Raider, and like, you know, like, I mean, he had some games where he got hot, so like there was potential there. But he's like, you know, man, like, I want to help you out, and like, you know, Henry Ruggs is a Raider, and like, James is a Raiders fan, so like we were like, all right, cool, like let's do it. But then like it like didn't go through for some reason.
So actually we figured out like why it didn't go through. I remember we explained, we like we told it to James. So first, just to set the basis of what I remember happening. So I remember the trade was supposed to go through on like a Thursday or mm-hmm. a Wednesday, and I was the trade whenever it was like supposed to go through, it didn't go through, mm-hmm. and it didn't give any notification at all. It like, it didn't say like the trade had been vetoed or anything. Mm-hmm. And I didn't even notice it until James had sent something to the group chat, and he was like, he was a little bit angry about it, which like I told him later on, I was like, but you're kind of getting the short end of the deal. Mm-hmm. Like I was like, I don't know. Like, but he was like a little bit angry about it. I don't know if I ever texted you or if you texted into the group chat, but I called James, and James was firmly convinced that, that we had vetoed it. So I was like, well, I know I didn't. So let me go, and I'm going to go call people. And I called my dad, and I was like, yo, did you veto this trade? And he was like, no. And he was like, what are you talking about? And I was like, no. And as far as I could tell, no one had vetoed the trade. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't, I didn't figure it out until a little bit later, whenever I had traded Ezekiel Elliott for Aaron Jones with Sean.
That's right, yeah.
And our trade didn't go through. And I was looking. And so pretty much what happened whenever those two things happen is that one of the players on your team was on the COVID, like little COVID slots, you know, like, cause you have the reserve things mm-hmm. for the people who had COVID. And if you keep them on there, even after they get off of the COVID, like even after they start playing again,
yeah,
it registers as your bench being full and you can't make the trades, and they just won't go through because your waivers won't go through either. And I looked back cause I had someone on my COVID thing who had been playing, and I was like, oh, maybe that's it. And I dropped them. We had the trade go through, and I went and looked back in the earlier weeks at your roster,
yeah,
the week that the trade was going down, and you had like Nelson Aguilar on the COVID thing when he was still playing, and that's whenever I had like sent it. Me or Dave had sent it to James. We're like, this is what happened that one week, and he was like, oh, that makes sense.
Okay.
But yeah, that's pretty much what happened. But I remember like it was like everybody was kind of just on edge because everyone was like, who vetoed this trade?
Yeah,
I didn't veto it. And James obviously thought that we were all lying and was like, no, you motherfuckers vetoed it. And we were like, no, we didn't.
Yeah,
was like, yeah, okay. Everyone was just like, and I didn't know, and like I didn't know if like, because like Dave, like that my dad had never, I've always known him to like never lie, like he's always pretty straightforward about shit. So whenever I asked him, I figured like if he did veto it, you know, he'd tell me. And then he was like, no, I didn't veto it. And I was like, well, somebody fucking had to.
Yeah.
Or the app's just bugged. I don't know. Yeah. But
yeah. The one thing I will say about waivers that was cool, like, you know, for those who don't know, I work in the middle of the night, and lately the last, you know, since fantasy football started in September, when I fry donuts, I have time, like just kind of like some free time. Like I drop them in the oil and then like I basically just let them sit till I have to flip them. And so like I felt like I kind of had an edge above everyone else, because like I would go on like on like Monday or Wednesday or whatever, and like I would start adding guys to my waiver at like 3 a.m. before anyone else was awake. And then like on Wednesday when the waiver is cleared, so like normally, I don't know when you get the notifications, but I would get it on like at like 9 a.m. But I found out that the waiver is actually cleared at like 3:30 in the morning. So I would jump on like while I was frying the donuts and see like who I got, who I didn't get. And then I'd be making moves like while everyone else was pretty much still asleep. And I was like, this is cool. Like this is going to get me far in this league, you know, just because I felt like I kind of had a little bit of an advantage because of working overnight.
Yeah, just a slight bit of edge just because you're up before everyone else. I felt that same way because I had to getting up. I had to, the way my schedule is I have to get up for PT in the mornings at like 5:30. And so like every time I'd go and sit in the parking lot and like wait for it to go get information, I'm like sitting there waiting and I'm checking all the shit. Most of the time, nobody else is up. Like you're up. But as far as like the majority of the league is not awake yet.
Yeah.
But yeah.
It's
I remember it being a lot more dramatic than we're making it sound to be as far as like all of it. But yeah, it was a pretty dramatic league, you know. I mean, there's so much shit. I remember you tweeting at one point in time being like
oh yeah,
you're being right. Being like the drama in my fantasy football league amazes me. Like, how do you...
Because it was just, like, I think that was, like, when the whole trade thing happened with Dave and he was about to quit. And I was like, dude, like, we're 4 weeks into this league and this is crazy. Like, this is awesome. I'm so glad I decided to do this.
It's just because of our you know, our family, our bloodline. Everybody's real competitive. Everybody wants to win.
Well, and everyone's got a personality of their own.
Yeah.
But the one thing I will say, too, is that, like, I made some questionable trades. I was too nice at some points. Like, so like, here's my problem is like, sometimes I was very nearsighted and I would think like emotionally and I'd be like, oh, I really like this player. So like, so I would trade for them. So like Anthony wanted my one wide receiver, Stephon Diggs, who ended up being like one of the best receivers in the league this past season. Phenomenal receiver, super good. You know, he'd put up like 20 points every game. And Anthony was like, hey, like, you need a running back. You want Todd Gurley? And now, for those who don't know, Todd Gurley is a running back who's on the decline of his career. By the end of the season, he was, like, scoring 3 points, or he was inactive, just, like, you know. And me, like, I always liked Todd Gurley. I was like, oh, like, yes. Like, that would be super cool.
So this is at the time whenever you were in a need for running backs.
So, like, you know, you kind of swooped in, and I was like, yeah, that sounds like a good idea. And then, like, it ended, I didn't even play. I ended up dropping him before the end of the season. I was like, well, that was stupid. But, like, I mean, it ended up working out because, like, I had David Montgomery, who got really hot. I had Jonathan Taylor, who got really hot towards the end. Miles Sanders had, like, one or two good games. So, like, it ended up working out for me in the end. But then, like, there was also the other trade Derrick Henry, who was the first player I drafted and who ended up leading the league in rushing yards. He was like the best running back this year. His team, the Tennessee Titans, kept having COVID issues and like they didn't play and they kept pushing games back. And I was like, dude, like I can't have this guy sitting on my bench for another week. It was like 2 or 3 weeks of this going on. So Joe reaches out to me and he's like, hey, like I'll trade you David Montgomery, who's the Bears running back, for Derrick Henry. And I was like, yeah, like I need a running back.
It was James. It was James.
And so like it ended up happening that like, of course, a week after this trade happens, the Titans are back to normal. Derrick Henry he runs for like over 200 yards, has like 3 touchdowns. I was like, dude, that's my luck. And so like I was just like too nice when it came to trading. And so like that's definitely
you just gotta see. It's obviously like, you know, like it's just your first year playing fantasy. So like there's no way to tell, but like, yeah, it's like whenever you draft guys like Derrick Henry, I would keep that motherfucker unless someone offers me, you know, huge.
Yeah.
The only thing that I can say to where like I did something like that was Michael Thomas. And if, for those that don't know, Michael Thomas was the number one wide receiver last year, not this previous year.
He's a crybaby.
Yeah, and there was a bunch of shit going on with him during the whole season. He got hurt after his first week and pretty much did not play until about 10 or 11 weeks later.
Mm-hmm.
And it was really annoying because every week I'd check it and it was like, he's questionable, he might play. And it's like, no, he won't. And I eventually just folded. I traded him for like, I don't remember who I traded him for, but it was someone just like not, it wasn't someone who was amazing. It was like Ronald Jones, who's good, but he didn't have like the amazing year that everyone thought he would.
Yeah.
But yeah.
That was the one thing I noticed. I was just like too nice. And so like this year I'm like not going to be like that. Because the thing is like I'd see a guy on waivers or like just like free agency and I'd be like, oh, I should pick him up. But then I'd think, no, I don't want to hog all the good players. Like someone else, and like now in hindsight, I'm like, dude, like that's how you gotta be if you want to win. Like, I am astonished that I made it to the playoffs.
Like, it's another thing with like fantasy football is that like it forces you to be so untruthful.
Yeah.
And like kind of a snake in a way, man. Like I remember whenever I traded you traded me Stephon Diggs for Todd Gurley, and I needed a wide receiver because I'd recently traded away most of my stock for running backs, and I had underwhelming running backs. They weren't amazing. I had guys like Todd Gurley, Ronald Jones, and I had a few guys that were like good players from week to week, but you know, they weren't amazing. And I really needed that really good number one wide receiver because I was expecting it to be Michael Thomas, and it wasn't him.
Yeah.
And so I noticed that he had like a you know, good little amount of wide receivers, and I texted you and I was like, I was thinking about asking for who was it, Cole Beasley or someone, and I was like, I'll trade you Cole Beasley for you know, I'll give you Todd Gurley. And then I ended up like telling you, I was like, you know what, do Stephon Diggs, you know, he has a tough schedule coming up whenever I knew that he was gonna go off. And I was like you need a running back. Todd Gurley is gonna consistently put up 14-15 points. He's a good running back. He's a little bit touchdown dependent, but he scores just about every game. And I was like sitting there just like, I remember thinking like, man, I'm lying to him right now.
Yeah.
Because Todd Gurley is not that great. But yeah, I mean, you bid on it. And I was like,
because it was an emotional decision. Cause I think I had tried getting him off of waivers earlier in the season. And then like Bethany took him and I was like, oh man. Like, so I was like, yeah, you know, but yeah, I don't know. So lessons learned. And it's a surprise that I made it to the playoffs. And it's so like, for those who haven't gathered it already, this is a family fantasy football league. Pretty much. Aside from Sean, I think he's one of James's friends. But but yeah, it's like pretty much a fantasy, like a family run fantasy football league. And it ended up being in the playoffs. Bethany, who is Dave's fiance, she had the best record. Dave, who I think he was like fourth or something like that. And then
fourth.
Who's Dave's son, and then me, who like I'm, you know, your cousin. So it was, and I just remember being like, I was like, you know, this is kind of bullshit. I was like, Dave's in, Anthony's in, Bethany's in, they're all pretty much from the same household. I was like, that's not cool. So I was like, I gotta win now, you know. And like I had just, so my last week of the season I beat Dave, and then I was like, well, now I gotta beat Dave for a second game in a row. And I somehow did it. And I was like, dude, Dave is probably so pissed right now. Like, cause knowing Dave, like, it's just funny, man.
I remember like every gotta bring out the belt.
Oh yeah,
you know, I can be able to see it, but I did get it. It's pretty nice, man. But yeah, I remember every week that you won, and like we said, my dad is very very energetic about it.
Yes.
And every week that you won, I always got these same exact texts from him, and it was like, Matt's the luckiest fucking fantasy player I've ever seen. This way, he's one of those garbage ass players like David Montgomery. Like, he hasn't done shit all year, and now all of a sudden he has 28 points this week, and it's like, I was like, yeah, man,
that's how it works. That's like, you know, like I got Jonathan Taylor, like he had a really good couple weeks, and then I got him, and then he put up like 5 points like for the next 2 weeks, and I was like, man, this sucks. So it's literally just a game of chance. Like, it just depends on how they do in their actual games. So like, you can never predict that. Like Russell Wilson, my quarterback, he was like an MVP candidate for like the first half of the season, and then he just started sucking like the second half of, and like Dave kept trying to get me to trade for him, and I was like, dude, no. Like, but like, you know, I don't know, it is what it is, man. It was a lot of fun.
Oh, it's fun. And just, and we'll be you know, I'm hoping that we can continue doing this league for, you know, a good few years, because it's like a break from reality.
Oh yeah,
you know,
for sure.
Yeah, you know, I mean, every day going to work or going to school and whatever you have to do, and then for a brief 30 minutes you might be able to sit there on your phone and check the fantasy app and yeah. be like, okay, maybe I should play this dude this week, and you know, it's kind of a break from reality.
Yeah, for sure. And I mean, obviously people couldn't see it. You know what? I think I have a video from Zoom though. I may put it on the Instagram, but Anthony won the championship at the end of the year, because it came down to him and Bethany, and I was like, dude, you have to beat Bethany. Like, she's just been too good this year. And yeah, so our fantasy league has a wrestling belt for whoever wins. It was passed down from Dave to Anthony, and you know, I don't know, man. I kept telling everyone, if I win that belt, I'm taking it everywhere with me. Like, I was going to take pictures with it at Q-Mart. I was going to take pictures with it at Walmart. I was going to start sending pictures to the chat.
But did you see the video of...
Yes.
Of me and, yeah.
So
that was
good.
Very well scripted. But, yeah, it was... the funny thing about the belt is that we didn't know. Like, no one knew. If I remember correctly, I remember it was, like, Joe. Mm-hmm. And Walt Willie just kind of, you know, bought it and just kind of sent it to Dave. Mm-hmm. And he got it. He was like, nice, okay. And then he kept it for the remainder of the season. And we were talking about it. It's almost like, in a way, it's almost like a punishment for like winning the league and then losing, because you do have to mail that belt. And that's one thing that my dad told me after the season. He was like, I'm just glad that it came down to you and Beth in the championship, so I didn't have to mail this fucking belt anywhere.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah.
I mean, maybe like in the future, maybe a suggestion, like maybe we could have both parties like do go halvesies on shipping. Like,
well, I was thinking, I always thought, I was like, maybe we should do like the person who's last in the league as their punishment has to pay for the shipping and handling of the belt.
You know, I remember there was a talk early in the season too about getting like a toilet bowl trophy for whoever was last. And I actually looked into it, and I found a toilet bowl trophy, and I was literally thinking about buying and just mailing it to whoever. And I was like, you know what? I'll proudly display that if I'm last. Like, I don't care. Yeah, lots of fun, man. Good stuff. Good segue, though, into when you guys came up to visit. It was like December 2019, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was your first time in Pennsylvania after, you know, a long time. And like I said, like, we had grown up. We'd both experienced, you know, a lot of different stuff. And I was like, hey, I'm going to take you to Q-Mart. And for, you know, for those who have listened to the podcast, you know that I love Q-Mart. You know that I've done lots of dumb stuff at Q-Mart. The episode that I did on Q-Mart actually garnered some controversy, which is great.
What controversy was that?
So I don't know if you saw it. You said you listened to some of the episodes. So Sean and I did an episode about Q-Mart, and when we would go watch like the wrestling that was there.
I want to be a Q-Mart wrestler. I did. Yeah. I had just listened to that. Yeah.
So the referee that we talked about that we heckled, and the guy, he's actually in the artwork of the episode. Sean and I would heckle this referee every month. We would go, we would, you know, some months we'd build him up, some months we'd tear him down. And it basically got to the point where like we had started a meme page where we would like take all his cringy pictures and edit him into different like situations. Somehow he and Sean ended up like following each other a few years ago when Sean posted like the episode and was like, hey, check this new episode out. This dude got so pissed. like, so Sean, my brother-in-law, was on night shift, and so we're both at work at the same time, and he was texting me like, dude, do you see what's going on my Instagram? And this dude, Brickhouse, had seen the post of the artwork for the podcast episode, and then he started trying to like fight Sean on Instagram. And he was like, dude, like, why don't you, you know, come to Q-Mart? You know where I'm at. You know when I'm there. This dude's like a fat, dumpy piece of garbage. So, like, you know, and Sean's like, you know, a military. He's an army veteran. And, you know, like, he could probably kill someone with his bare hands if he had to. But, like, the thing is like, this fat, dumpy, middle-aged dude is like, oh, like, why don't you use a recent picture? You know, it's like, why? Because you got even fatter? Like, come on, man. So, like, he's trying to get Sean to come fight him, and then this dude's, like, posting this stuff on Instagram. Like, he posted a picture of a knife and was like, oh, my favorite blade, and, like, just, yeah, like, he posted...
Fucking cringy, man.
Yeah, he posted this other picture, and he's like, oh, waking up my old self, my true self, you know, people want to play games, you know, like, he's, like, 12 years old, just, like...
It's demon time.
Yeah, like, exactly.
Go savage mode.
So, like, it created a little bit of drama, but it was really funny. It was nice and entertaining to have, you know, something, you know, like, again, an escape from reality while I was at work. But, yeah, so, Q-Mart, for those who don't know, is a farmer's market in Quakertown, Pennsylvania. Quakertown has its nice areas, but then it has its very dumpy areas. I remember taking you there, and I was like, all right, dude, like, you're going to see Quakertown. Like, this is kind of the trashy area of, you know, where I live, or one of the trashier areas. And it's just like a little farmer's market, and there's some cool stores, for sure. You know, I love my little Q-Mart adventures, but we saw some interesting things there that night. I don't know how much you remember, but the points I wrote down, because it was around Christmas time, they had like a little ghetto Santa booth, and it was like this little tucked away room, like in one of the hallways, and like there was this couch, like a Christmas couch, but every time we walked past, it smelled like someone like shit their pants. And like the thing was, is like, you know, Q-Mart has its smells, and like, but that day in particular, the whole Q-Mart just smelled like someone was just walking around with like poop in their diaper or something. You know, like, I don't know if
I remember. I definitely remember the smell from that. If there was one thing that I took away from that whole night adventure, it was that.
Yeah.
I believe Allie, your little sister, and then Ashlyn, my little sister, didn't they go with us?
They did. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. But we had fun. I mean, like, there were some smells, and like, but the thing is every time we walked past this Santa couch, the smell got worse. So we were like, did Santa like shit himself on the couch? Like, what was going on there? I don't know. But
I don't remember a whole lot from that night. But it's kind of like, just because, you know, whenever like you see so much,
it's just so much weird, to take in. Yeah.
So much weird shit that it almost becomes normal.
Yeah.
And you know, I just walked by and just like, oh yeah, that's a dude with no teeth. Awesome. The fourth one tonight.
Yeah. And then the one other thing I had written down, you have this video. We were in a store and they had those like emo panda hats with like the long ears that you could like put your hands in. Like,
we're fucking furries.
We were just like walking around messing with stuff. I remember we went in this one store that had like loose toilet paper rolls, and you like threw one across the store or something, like just, and I was like, guys, like, I'm the one that's in charge of y'all. Like, I'm the oldest one here, so please don't get me arrested. Like,
you walked by. It was such like a little ghetto, you know, place. Just,
yeah.
There is like little booths set up with this older Korean woman, and like with this, and like, there's like this jewelry booth, and it's like $2 chains, and it's like, damn, I want to buy it and put it on and see how fast my neck turns green. Like, I just want to see it.
Yeah. And then one of the other fun things from that night, it was just one of those things where like, how long can we delay the inevitable, you know, going home and having to just like be stuck in the house again? So I took you guys to the Promenade Shops, which is just like a little outdoor mall, but we went in this bougie grocery store called Fresh Market. You know, so like there's this display, and it's still there today. Like, I went a couple months ago, it's still there. Right when you walk in, there's this display of these like fancy like bougie candy bars, just huge like bright wrapping paper. And like, I walked up to him, and we were like, oh, like Willy Wonka, what? And then like, I got down and I was like, here you go, guys, dinner. And I picked up like a whole stack of them, and then you started like humping my head, you know, just like being like wacky. And so like this dude, this creepy bald guy walks up to us, and like we thought, you know, I saw him out of the corner of my eyes, like, uh-oh, like we're about to get kicked out. And he walks up and he goes, "Did you ever meet him?" And you're just like, Willy Wonka? Like what?
Because I was wearing a Sidney Crosby Penguins jersey. And I remember us sitting there, and like I've been kicked out of multiple places, like, you know, Walmart and shit. And like it's just kind of like a normal thing in the teenage years, just go fuck around and get kicked out of places. But I totally had that same thought. I was like, oh man, this dude looks, he's wearing like a, you know, a dress shirt. He has his name tag. He works here. He's like the store manager or something. But he walks up and he taps me on the shoulder, and I'm like, fuck. And he's like, "Did you ever meet him?" Like really like under his breath, like he's amazed. Like, "Did you ever meet him?" And I was like, "Who the fuck?" And we were standing by like this cardboard cutout of Willy Wonka, and I'm like, "Him? No." And he was like, he was like, "No, Crosby." And I was like, "Nope, never met him." And he goes on this long, elaborate story about his son Jimmy, fucking little Jimmy. I don't know. It sounded like a make a wish story.
Yeah.
And he was like, "Yeah, I was a Boston Bruins fan, and then, we emailed the Penguins, and they sent him a jersey, and we actually got to meet Sidney Crosby." And then he goes into this elaborate description of Sidney Crosby. He's like, "He's about your height, but just so thick. He's so thick." And he's just like, he's like, I don't like, like fucking jizzing himself over the fact that Sidney Crosby. He was like,
"He's thick as a brick."
Yeah, I remember him saying those words. "He's just thick as a brick," and like he grabbed my shoulder, and I was like, "Don't fucking touch me, dude."
Yeah,
he was like, from like his chest to like his back, this fucking big man.
He's like three feet wide.
Yeah.
Well, and I remember like every time like we'd think like, "All right, like, you know, see you later, man. Have a nice night." He would start talking again, and it'd be like, "Good lord, man! Like, come on, like."
Like, I get that you're working, you know, hourly, but goddamn, get back to it, bro. Yeah. I just remember him being real weird, and like he had this really weird persona of just, he just wanted, I don't know, he was so enthusiastic about.
I also remember, I just remembered this. You said that you like were in a military family because Dave was just getting ready to retire from the army. Or he thought you meant that you were like in the military, and he's like, "Oh, thank you for your service."
Yeah, it was really awkward. He was asking, I don't remember how
he asked, like where we were from or something.
Yeah, and I mentioned that like I wasn't from here. I was like, "We're a military family," so, and he was like, "Oh, thank you for your service," and I shook my hand. And I like, it's so awkward that like you don't, you know, it's really weird. And it's actually leading into like, so where I am. And I'm in college at Auburn University in Montgomery. It's a smaller school. It's like a satellite school of Auburn University in Alabama. And I am like going to like ROTC classes. And it's just like officer training pretty much. Like after my 4 years of college, I'll go commission and then be an officer in the Army. But I'm not in by any means yet. But we have to wear our OCPs, or like it's the Army's uniform, the camo. Yeah. You have to wear those to the classes that you take. And every time that me and my roommate, every Thursday that we have this class, we walk out of our dorm in these camos, and like on the like little under a mile walk across campus, at least one person every single time stops us and is like, "Thank you for your service." And we're just like sitting there like, it's so awkward because like you don't want to be like, "No, you shouldn't be thanking me." But then it's going to lead a whole new conversation. And it's like, "Why are you guys wearing that then?"
Yeah.
"So you're not in, but you're wearing that?" And it's like so hard to explain to people. It's like, "No, you know what? Thanks."
So to wrap up, the main reason why we talked about having this episode was because you were hanging out with me when I was editing the episode about my first job. Worst episode I've ever done. I hate it. You were talking about, so at the time you were working for Sonic. You were like a manager of some sort. This was before you went to college full time.
Yeah.
And you were like, "Oh dude, like I have so many crazy stories from Sonic." And I was like, "Well, let's do it." So like right now, let's close out last segment of the pod. Let's get some Sonic stories, man.
So
I hope the one about the guy with the grill is on here, but I'll let you pick.
There's so many. So I was talking with my girlfriend earlier today about like what stories, because I was looking at like the quota for what we were going to talk about.
Yeah.
And to set it up, like I don't know if you guys like have many Sonics around where you are from.
It's maybe like one.
Yeah, it's a very big thing here down here in the South. There's quite a few,
mm-hmm.
and it's a huge like high school hangout spot. I started working there like a week before I turned 16, and so about 8 to 12 months into working there, I got promoted from like crew leader to manager, and I was an assistant for the general manager. And I remember I worked night shift for a while where I'd close the store, mm-hmm. and we closed at like 1 a.m. I remember, first of all, there was this dude, Brandon, who was very antisocial and just didn't really say shit. And it's like, that's like one thing. Like, I hate people too. Like, awesome. Like, it's fine with me. But like, whenever you're working with people, like, I remember it being antisocial to the point that annoyed you. Like, he would walk in and it was this really short, pudgy kid. And I'd be like, what's up, Brandon? Ready to have a good day? Fucking silence. Like, just no fucking answer. Dude, and I'm like, you're the worst, man.
That's how it is with me at my current job, but the opposite. Like, my boss will come in and not say anything to me. And, like, I never know whether this guy likes me or not. Because, like, I've tried to be like, hey, good morning. How are you doing? Or, like, what's up, man? And he's just like, meh. Like,
So this Brandon kid, right? Was very just not very common sense smart, and this he was a cook, right? So pretty much inside of Sonic we have this little blade thing, and it's about half a foot long, and like, you know, has a handle on it, and you use this shit to kind of like cut burgers and sandwiches in half, mm-hmm. if people want it cut in half like on their order.
Yeah.
So I remember one night whenever I was closing, we were getting closer to closing. And I always told my cooks to like start breaking down shit to wash dishes, mm-hmm. so that we could get out like, you know, at a reasonable time and we wouldn't have to stay past close more than 30 minutes.
Yeah.
And that's always one of the last things that you wash to like, you know, break down, because it's really easy. You just kind of just spray it off and there's not a whole lot of anything on it. It's not like you have to smear grease off of it. So I got a call on the headset in Sonic. And for those that don't know, if you ever go to a Sonic, it's really fucking annoying to press that little red button because the noise that it makes is and if you want to get their attention, press it over and over and over again because it just goes and it's so annoying. But I got a call and it was this dude on the other line and he was like, hey, can I get a manager out here? So I walked out there and I look and I was like, what's up? What can I help you with? And he shows me this burger that's been unwrapped out of the wrapping and it's like fucking mauled. It looks like a bear got a hold of it. It's like torn apart and like there's like finger marks in it and like the sauce is everywhere and it's really gross. And I was looking at it and he was like, this is how I got the sandwich. And I was like, that's how you got it? Because like it was like torn apart like by like hands. You see fingerprints inside of the bun.
What?
And I was like, that's how you got it? And he was like, yeah, that's how I got it. So he was like, he was real cool. Like kudos to the dude because I would have been really pissed.
Yeah.
He was like, dude, I just don't even want to eat here anymore. Like, I just want my money back. I just want a refund. Like, you have to. I was like, I was apologizing. Like, my manager came out and I was like, I'm so sorry. Here's three free meals. Like, you can come back whenever you want to if you ever want to come back. I just refunded it all back onto your card and explained it all to him. And I asked for the burger back and I was like, can I take this in? Because I'm about to ream someone's ass. And I walked inside and you know Gordon Ramsay, like the the world renowned chef and how he screams and calls people donuts and shit.
Oh yeah.
And I remember walking in and feeling like Gordon Ramsay because I walked in with the fucking sandwich in my hand and I'm like walking to the back through everybody just like parting the fucking Red Sea. Just everyone's moving out of the way because I looked fucking furious. And I looked back there to the person who was on grill, which was Brandon. And I said, did you do this? And he just didn't say shit to me. And I took the fucking sandwich and I threw it against the wall. And I was like, who the fuck did this? And I like yelled. And he was like, I did. And I was like, why? Why? Like, I was at a loss for words. I was like, you tore it apart with your bare fucking hands. And he was like, and his excuse was the little, cutter thing. Yeah. He was like, the little the little cutter, the little chopper thing, it wasn't here. We had already washed it.
Oh,
I was like,
God.
And I blew the fuck up. And I slammed my fucking fist against like the side of the grill. And I was like, go fucking get it, dumbass. And I was so fucking furious. Jeez. Man.
People are so stupid.
Yeah. That's one of the biggest things that I remember because and I told my boss later and he was like, did you fire him? And I was like, no, I just sent him home that night. Like, I didn't want to fire him and then get you pissed off about it, but because we were short all the time.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
And then, of course there's the story of the guy burning his face off on the grill. Oh,
this is my favorite.
So we had, inside of Sonic, the floors are like just this very, it's these like gray floors and they're very slick, especially whenever there's grease all over the place and whatever else. So we tell everyone that they're supposed to get non-slip shoes. And it's in the contract that like, if you hurt yourself while you're not wearing non-slip shoes, we're not liable for it.
Yeah.
And so this dude's wearing this dude, he's this really, really big, big dude. This like 6'6" dude. Damn, what was his name? We're gonna go with his name being Bryce, just because I can't remember exactly what it was. But I told Bryce whenever he first started working, I was like, yo, you need to get some non-slip shoes because you're 6 foot fucking six and 250. And if you fall, you might take down the whole fucking store with you.
Yeah.
And he was like, okay, yeah, I'll get on it. He never got on it. he pretty much the way that the grill was set up is it's this massive grill that you can cook a lot of meat on. And each side varies on the temperatures. It's like 450 degrees all the way halfway until it gets to like 300 and 200. And whenever we clean the grill every night, we have these grill bricks and we use like a cold grease because it gets like a lot of the shit off. And he was like leaning over this massive grill, just kind of trying to scrub it. And he was on one foot and his one foot slipped and he caught himself on the grill, putting his hands just flat on the grill and his face just planting on the grill. And the grill is still on because you have to clean it with the grill on or else everything gets like cold and you know whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
And we, long story short, we pretty much had, I remember hearing him like, ah, and I was like, what the fuck? And I walked over there and I saw him peeling his face off the grill. Oh. And I was like, oh man. I was like, that sucks. And I sent him home. We ended up having to give him workers compensation. Yeah, but yeah. We did it like being nice, but we shouldn't have because the motherfucker wasn't wearing non-slips. But he was I remember Bryce I remember us having to scrape his face off the grill, and I was like, man, this is fucking gnarly, dude.
His skin peeled off, like
it wasn't on there for long, but you gotta think at 450 degrees, yeah, if you put anything on there for a split second, and he pretty much got off, but like he got off pretty quickly, but his hands were burnt and he got burns on his face. And that's one thing that it was so gnarly. And I told like all of my friends and like my girlfriend about it. Yeah. And I was like, don't fucking eat there because there's his skin. His skin is still on that grill somewhere. Like there's a little residue of it.
That's so bad.
As far as other Sonic stories, it's man, just like just so much shit. Just getting yelled at by customers. The funniest thing by far is So I don't know if you knew this, but after I quit the Sonic in Troy, Alabama, whenever I moved to Montgomery, Alabama, I started working at Sonic here.
Yeah.
And the Sonic here is a lot different from the Sonic in Troy. What I mean by that is that I was the token white guy. I was the only white dude in the store.
Oh,
right?
Yeah, you told me about that. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And it was real, real cool with me. I was chill. I thought they were all hilarious and, you know, all my coworkers were liked me and they were like, you know, hey, white boy, you know, like this fucking, just, you know, whatever. Yeah. But I remember our customers were always, they're pretty bad. And inside of this mall, East Chase. And I remember one day, this is by far the biggest thing that I had noticed out of this store was I was working in the kitchen. I was like, as a cook, because they hired me and they were like, if you're going to be a cook for like a month or two, and then we're going to promote you to manager. And I was like, okay, cool. And I was in the kitchen working with this little black dude, Carl. Mm-hmm. Carl, real feisty. He's like 5'6", real scrawny dude, but like he talks a lot of shit.
Yeah.
And I remember one day this customer walked inside of Sonic, which you're not supposed to do that. You're supposed to, you know, like press the red button, jackass. And this dude, huge dude, 6'5", giant, just to give you a description, he was fucking banging. Like he had a red backwards hat on. He had a red flag, like a red scarf hanging out of the side of his pocket.
Mm.
Tattoos all up and down his arms. Had like black trousers on, boots, and then like a white wife beater, mm-hmm. like stains on it. And then he also had 3 teardrops.
Mm-hmm.
You know what those mean?
Isn't that like when you kill someone, or?
From what I know, from pretty much. But he looked pretty much too intimidating for me to be like, fuck, you know,
yeah,
I'm not gonna fucking talk to him. But he walks in. And he stands there with his arms like kind of folded. He isn't looking at anybody. He's just kind of just looking over everybody. He's like, "Hey, yo, I had a mobile order," and no one answers. And Carl is next to me, and he's like sitting there, and he's with it. Sonic's not a big store, so mm-hmm. like pretty much anything that you say can be within the earshot of anybody. And Carl's sitting there, and he's pretty loud. He's like looking at me. He's like, "Who the fuck does this motherfucker think he is? He's talking all this. Come up here, like stand outside, dumbass," and like talking shit. And this dude, the customer, looks back and he looked down directly at Carl and he's like, "What you looking at, little homie?" And I was like, "Oh shit." And I just kind of stepped back behind Carl. And the thing that I expected Carl to do, he did not. I expected Carl to be like, nothing, bro. Like, you're good. So Carl decided to look back at this black dude and at this big old fucking customer. And he's like, Carl looks at him after the dude looks at him. He's like, "What you looking at, little homie?" And Carl does not miss a beat and goes, "You motherfucker." And oh, I, Lord. The everything, like you could hear a pin drop in there. And I was like, "Oh shit." And I was like, "Fuck, man." And they pretty much just went back and forth. Nothing really came of it. Carl, the customer, looked back and was like, "I promise you ain't looking at me." And Carl was like, "Yeah, I bet I am." And and they just kept talking shit. And then finally the manager was like, "Sir, I'm gonna need you to get the fuck up out of our store." And I was like, "All right, yeah, fucking get his ass out of here." About 10 minutes of silence went by and I'm like working next to Carl and I look over at him, just kind of pause, and I'm like, "Yo, Carl." He's like, "What's up?" And I was like, "You know you probably would have got your ass beat, right?" He was like, "No, I got hands." I was like, "Okay, yeah, all right, man. If you say so, Carl." But it was just so eventful,
dude. That's awesome. That's what happens when you work with the public, man. Like you get, I don't know. And I'm sure you know Alabama is a different world than the Lehigh Valley.
Yeah, it is. It's different. There's a lot of there's a lot more discrimination based off of race, mm-hmm. ethnicity, you know, like even like, you know, gender. Like I remember one time a customer, there was a girl who was also a manager with me and Troy, and like she went out, she had like answered an order and like went outside to go help somebody, and she came back inside furious, and mm-hmm. I was like, "What the fuck is wrong?" And she was like, "That fucking customer out there told me that he wasn't going to take me seriously and he wanted to talk to a male manager." And I was like, "Oh, okay." Jeez. So I just went outside and asked him to leave. I was like, "Nah, wow. You're just going to leave, bro." Wow. I also had somebody threaten to throw burgers in my face. Like, just like this dude who's real mad. He had asked like for his order to be remade 3 times. And I was like, after like the second time, I was like, "All right, I'm going to go in there, personally make it. Tell me exactly how much you want, exactly, you know, whatever." He's like, "I want extra, extra onion. I want a lot of onion on it." And I was like, "Okay." So I made it with a fuck ton of onions. And I brought it and he opened it and he was like, "You told me that you was going to make it. Now I want to throw this fucking burger in your face. You know how mad I am?" And I was just like, "All right, whatever."
Yeah.
And he's so numb to it whenever you work with the public so much. That, like, oh, yeah. Like,
it's wild, man. Crazy times, crazy stories, lots of fun. I think that just about wraps it up, man. Thank you for coming on. This was a lot of fun. I think we covered a lot of stuff. Fantasy football, drama, Q-Mart, thick as a brick Crosby, and then wrapped up with some Sonic. I hope everyone listening, hope you all enjoyed. Give us a follow here on SoundCloud at Fueled by Coffee Podcast. We appreciate your support. We have merch. We have stickers. We have t-shirts. Give us a follow on Instagram at Fueled by Coffee Pod. As always, it was a pleasure. Looking forward to the future episodes. We drop them every 2 weeks. Anthony, thank you for your time. It was fun.
Absolutely.
And absolutely. Hoping to see you guys soon, sooner rather than later.